Welcome to the second episode of the Gospel Geek Podcast. I hope you enjoyed the first one and learned about one of America's favorite gospel artists. Before we dive into the main featured artist for today's program, I wanted to talk about what Southern gospel music is and to talk about the adversity surrounding the genre in churches. First, Southern gospel music is its own genre, and as we talked about in the last episode, there are many styles of gospel music. One of the biggest debates that have been going on in churches for the last 5 to 10 years is what style of gospel music to sing in church. Some churches prefer the contemporary praise and worship style of music, while others prefer the traditional Southern gospel and hymn style of music in church. Some churches had decided to split the congregation into two services for the different styles of music, but I believe it divides the church. Some other churches have found a way to blend the music together so that there are a few traditional songs being sung and a few praise and worship songs being sung too. I am for the blending of the services because I have always grown up liking the traditional music, but also believe there is room for some of both if it is presented well, and that the congregation still is involved, which has not been the case in a lot of modern churches today. The style of Southern gospel music is done best when the redback hymnal is used and the congregation can sing along with the different musical parts that the song was written in. There are some good things and worshipful moments that come out of the modern style of music, but for me, the old style will never be replaced and will continue to live on in the church. So let's move on to today's featured artist, the Perrys. Today, I wanted to talk about one of the longest running mixed groups in Southern gospel music, the Perrys. You will learn about their history and why they were a major influence on me, both personally and spiritually. Perry started in Dawsonville, Georgia, around the year 1970. The original group consisted of siblings Deborah, Randy, and Libby Perry. In fact, they were known as God's Little People because of their stature. 15 years later, the Perrys added a bass singer to the group, and that was Tracy Stuffel. Libby and Tracy got married in 1987, so the Perrys became an all-family group again for a few years until Deborah left. They went through multiple soprano changes, so in 2000 they hired a male singer rather than a soprano. Some more of their history will be revealed in a later segment of the show. The Perrys do a great job at doing a cappella songs, and this is a great example of a classic song titled Holy Manna. The Perrys lineup for this song was Randy, Deborah, and Libby Perry, along with Tracy singing bass. So enjoy Holy Manna from the 1990 Perrys lineup.
Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new.
Perrys enjoy singing this style of music that offer old-fashioned convention singing. This song called Come and Get Me is one of those songs that the groups like to do in order to show off the bass singer, in this case because Tracy was very low for a mixed group like the Perrys. This was featured on their 2007 recording titled Look No Further. It featured members Nick Trammell singing baritone, Joseph Habedank singing lead, and Libby and Tracy also enjoy this fun song called Come and Get Me.
I can hardly wait for the trumpet to sound.
Lord, I can hardly wait for my robe and crown.
My robe and crown.
Gonna
shout the news. I'll never worry, never sigh. I'll never have the blues. I want to go up yonder where I'll never more roam. Come and get me, Lord, and carry me home.
Come and get me, Lord, and take me.
Come and carry me home. I never want to ramble.
Never want to roam.
I want to down there to that happy home in the sky, where my soul shall live forevermore and nevermore die. Preparations have been made and I am ready to fly. Come and take me in the by and by.
Swing low,
swing low,
swing low,
swing low,
sweet chariot,
swing low,
swing low.
I want to go up yonder where I'll nevermore roam. Come and get me, Lord, and carry me home. Come and get me, Lord, and carry me home.
Let's dive back into some more of the Perry's history, when they became a traditional quartet, with Libby singing a higher part and Tracy singing a lower bass part. This was accomplished by adding lead singer Lauren Harris and baritone Joseph Habedank. This combination was very successful, with hit songs like I Rest My Case at the Cross, Calvary Answers for Me, and I Wish I Could Have Been There. During this time, they also recorded multiple albums of Remembering the Happy Goodmans. These songs are still being sung today. The group had a string of hit songs in the early 2010s, with their baritone singer being moved up into the lead spot and started writing songs. The group was really going strong when they took a personal hit with their MC and bass singer Tracy Stuffel having a stroke while driving. Throughout the next few years, he went through a bunch of health issues, leading to being paralyzed in a wheelchair and eventually passing away. This took a toll on the group, both personally and financially, but they continued with living in charge of the group and having great singers like Troy Peach and Andrew Goldman. During the middle of 2020, those two members made the decision to pursue other options and lead the group due to financial struggles with the group from COVID and other situations throughout the last few years. But the Perrys still travel when they can and still provide that great mixed group sound that they have been known for over 40 years. The Perrys have had deep connections with me personally because my parents met at a Perrys concert back in the 90s. Neither one of them went to that church, but they both enjoyed Southern gospel music. My mom arrived at the concert first with a friend, and my dad came in later. The concert was very packed, so he decided to sit beside my mom, and they began talking. At the intermission of the concert, Dad wanted to leave because he had to get up for work early the next morning, but he was pinned in because of the huge crowd of cards. So he went back in and watched the rest of the concert. When it was over, they both came outside together, and both my mom and my dad were pinned in. So they decided to exchange numbers, and as they say, the rest is history. Another personal story concerning the Perrys was when my family and I attended a Perrys concert while I was in high school. It was around the time I was looking for colleges that would be interested in attending. So the lead singer at the time, Andrew Goldman, did the Perrys product pitch that night, and he mentioned about a college that he went to and taught at. He had some brochures on the table that night, so we picked up one, and I talked to him about the school that night. Long story short, I decided to attend that college, and I am now in my junior year at Oakland City University, and I'm also engaged to my fiance, Hannah, who I met on the first student acceptance day. As you can see, my family and I are not only grateful to the Perrys for their music ministry and for their calling, but their work has now created two couples getting married and living godly lives for Christ. Here is an interview I did with Andrew Goldman, talking about his time at Oakland City and singing with the Perrys.
Hey, welcome to the interview part of this series. I am with Andrew Goldman today, a former member of the Perrys and an Oakland City alumni. So, hello Andrew, how are you doing?
Hey Brandon, what's up, man?
Not much. So, I want to get into some questions today. Since you were a former Oakland City alumni, what was the best thing that you had learned here, especially that you have used in singing and just life in general?
Well, golly, it's been a few years since I've been to Oakland City. Mm-hmm. And, I worked there for a while, studied music there. Started in 2008 and graduated in 2012, studied music, and got an opportunity to work with Cynthia Rotana, Mrs. Rotana, who not only has been one of my biggest encouragers, but has been a friend over the years. And I'm not just saying that because she's tuned in. she did wonders with my voice vocally, just to to help with stamina, tone, register, placement. You know, we focused on classical music when I was there, studying with her. She really, really helped the longevity of my voice over the last few years. I was with the Perrys for 7 years. We did 225 days a year, nonstop, hard singing, and wouldn't have been able to do that vocally without her. So it was I cherish that for sure.
Sounds good. So, like, going into the Perrys, like, kind of speaking about that, how did you get with them? Like, who did you contact, or did they contact you, or like, how was the process in that?
Well, I've been friends with Ernie Haas, who is another Oakland City University alumni, over the years, and we were just I just kept in touch over the years, and he knew that I wanted to sing full time, and so he I believe he gave them my contact information. I got a random text from Libby one night. This was April of 2014. And she sent me a text, and I met up with him a couple weeks later in Bedford, Indiana, and was supposed to just audition. Just sing a few songs beforehand. They wanted me to do the first half of the concert, and they ended up just leaving me on stage. I did the whole concert. That was in April of 14. And in May, I officially started with them. I got married in June, which is crazy. But, so that was May of 2014. And then was with them until September of 2020.
That's a great story. So while you're with them, what was your favorite song to sing with them, and why?
Golly, there are so many Perry songs that, as far as, I mean, I can't name a specific favorite one that I enjoyed singing. I mean, I love so many. There was a lot of the older songs that I enjoyed singing. Probably the most recent, you know, was Never, that little girl is smiling at you, cheesing it up. Never Gets Old was probably my favorite, just because, I mean, it was the most radio play that we had, that and it carried him, did very well for us in the last few years. So I enjoyed singing those and seeing how, you know, songs that mean so much to me and the Perrys affect people's lives, and it was great. Yeah,
one of the memories that I remember about you was on the cruise. I think it was C.T. Townsend had just preached, and you guys, he wanted you guys to sing "He Will Hide Me," I think.
Oh, yes, that was incredible.
I just remember, and I know that was like a big song, and I remember just you singing that one. That's like, and everybody was just going nuts over it. And I just, I just remember you, him, but he was like all jumping up and down and wrapped around you.
It was awesome. Wow. God really moved, man. Even in the middle of the ocean, God just really did a big thing, and that was a great memory for sure.
I bet you missed the cruises, right?
I missed the heat, the warmth. Sometimes it's a long time being away from family. Right. My wife didn't get to go with me last time, so that was tough. But
So speaking about your family, I think you have a baby now and wife.
Can you see her?
Yeah.
She just woke up from a nap.
Oh boy.
Yeah, she'll be a year old next week. Can you say hi? Can you say hi? Oh goodness. She'll be a year old. She was a COVID baby. She was born March 4th, 2020, and then COVID hit right after that. So
yeah, you probably hope she doesn't remember that year, huh?
and she actually she actually had COVID back in July.
Oh wow.
Her and her mom and me, we all did, and she had about 3-4 days of fever and aches, and but she got through it. So she's tough. She doesn't like me wearing hats. Look at the camera, say hi. Let the camera say hi. Say hi. Hi.
There we go.
Oh, goodness.
So, what are you currently doing now? Are you like in a church, music ministry, just?
Well, just things here and there. I've been filling in. I've done some driving and running some sound for some events and some lighting. But as far as full time, I'm just home with my little girl and been able to spend time with my dad. My dad has been battling some health issues over the last 4 or 5 years, and so I've been able to be available, which has been great. Been great. You know, I do miss singing, you know, but I've been with my little girl every day for her first year of her life. And I cherish that completely. You can't, totally. Yeah, I'll never get that back.
Nope. That's right.
Yep. No.
Probably the biggest question, and since we're covering mostly the Perry stuff, what do you feel like you accomplished with them, and what do you feel like your impact was on their ministry, like personally and musically, spiritually, anything you want to talk about?
Well, you know, the Perrys have gone through so much over the last 10, 12 years, with Tracy's stroke and Libby's had two heart attacks. And so as far as, you know, I don't want to say an impact that I left, but I felt like the team that we had through those times was incredible, all the way up to the bus wreck we had in March of 2019. And what are you doing? I think the team that we had, you know, even when I was there, when I joined in 14, Brian Walker was singing baritone, and he had been with them through Tracy's stroke and getting back on the road, and then I came along and then Troy Peach came 6-7 months after that, and I just think the team that we had with Troy and Brian and Jared and Libby and Tracy, we just had a great team that was able to really see God move in a lot of ways through people's lives and as much traveling as we did, and really the strength that we had as a team got us through that. You know, with Tracy passing away and. So unexpected, and then the bus wreck, and you know, we went with a year. We were in 13 different buses, and it was just crazy trying to get that back together. And then COVID hit, and you know, it was really, really tough. You know, dates were gone, you know, and then my family, we got COVID, and I had to miss there, and we didn't make a big deal about that.
Right.
You know, thankfully we had it pretty easy.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people that haven't, but, you know, I just think in a sense, the team that we've had was kind of the biggest impact for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I couldn't have done it without them. You know, you can't be gone. You get up, you're a family on the road, you know, being gone that much. And, so I feel like that was the biggest impact, on me. And I think for the Perrys was the team that we had.
Right. And I know you guys connected so much, and you still connect, you know, after you guys, you know, departed, like, I know you did Choice Church. You sung at Choice Church, I think, for Christmas.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm going to go, my wife and I will be back down there for their Easter program as well, so we're all still buddies. I talk to Jared every now and then, and Libby, I think I'm gonna try to go see them tomorrow. Actually, they're gonna be up just north of Oakland City in Robinson, Illinois, in that Palestine area.
Right.
Yeah. So I think I'm gonna go show up and surprise them.
That's great. So. Yeah. Well, always a family, huh?
Absolutely. Hopefully that bus is clean.
I know those buses are. I talked about it in my last podcast about riding on the buses and how they're like. And I know it's rough. So like, I kind of talk about that for a few minutes. Like, I mean, I know they break down a lot, and then they, like, I mean, the how it feels riding on them. I know it's like the bunks and stuff. Like, I mean, does it? Like,
you know, there's nothing like it, honestly. Right. I mean, it's you know, it's like your second home. When you're, I was, you know, in the 7 years that I was there. You know, I spent more time on the bus than I did at my in my own home, you know. Mm-hmm. And so it just becomes part of you. You know, when you close that bunk and it's pitch black and you're, mm-hmm. it, you're kind of moving, kind of rocks you to sleep. Mm-hmm. It's amazing, actually. Right. And my bunk was right over the generator, so I always had that kind of, you know, probably the most people, they probably wouldn't be able to handle that, but I loved it. Mm-hmm. And then I started driving, you know, in 2018 and fell in love with buses all over again. And, you know, it's a, they have to be ran for sure. They cannot sit, but, they do break down and it's just, it's a necessary evil, you know. For as much as we were gone, we had to be able to have something like that to be able to do what we did. But you know, there are times, and but it's rough. And of course, you know, like I said, the bus wreck,
you never know. It was just the randomest thing. Like, I mean, it's just,
you never know. But if we had been anything else, I think it could have been a lot worse, you know. Mm-hmm. So I'm thankful.
Things pile up, and it just, the time wise, it just, everything just piled up at scene, and that's kind of how it just kind of just everything shut down.
Absolutely.
Before we go here, last thing, I just want to talk about like the Southern Gospel family and how, like, when you were with the Perrys, I know the Perrys sung with groups a lot, you know, at the Bill Bailey concerts and you know, the Lebanon Sing and stuff like that. So like, talk about the Southern Gospel community as a family and like what that meant to you and like how everybody showed together.
It was incredible. I still stay in contact with many guys from other groups and the times that we got to work together, and you know, it was two or three dates and then we wouldn't see each other for two or three weeks. Mm-hmm. But once we got back together, it was just like family again, and always stayed in contact. And I miss those times, man. It's just like, you know, it's just, you know, like if you're in your church, your fellowship with your mm-hmm. church family, it's just the same kind of concept. And when we got together, no competition. I mean, there's always a friendly competition, you know, with your buddies. That's just kind of how it is. But it wasn't bad, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It was. Great and fun. We had a good time and got to see God move through people's songs live, you know, that you hear on the radio and mm-hmm. your buddy's songs that they're doing. So I miss those times. And you know, in the summer and mm-hmm. spring, we did a lot of those dates. You had the James D. Vaughan Festival, and the Quartet Convention is in the fall, and Lebanon Sing in August. And I miss those things. We did a lot of Bill Bailey dates, and I miss those. I miss seeing my buddies, but I've stayed in contact with them mm-hmm. over the years, over the last year that I've been gone. And I miss it, but man, the camaraderie of all the other groups out on the road, mm-hmm. you know, it's second to none.
Music, like, there's no other music that's kind of like such a family as Southern Gospel, I feel like.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I just had a recent opportunity. I did some driving on the Pits Deep Tour, and there's that family camaraderie there, but it's different. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They all love each other and are spending time together, but you know, in the Southern Gospel world, it seems like we were, I don't want to say closer, but it just had a different feel. Mm-hmm. And I miss that for sure.
Right, yeah. All right, yeah, sounds good. Thank you for joining me today.
Hey, man, it's been an honor. Thanks for having me in.
All right.
I can't wait to hear the podcast.
All right, thanks.
All right.
See you later.
See ya.
I definitely enjoyed that interview with Andrew, and I hope you did too. Before we close today, I wanted to talk about one of the most underrated bass singers in gospel music, and that was Tracy Stuffel of the Perrys. He had the techniques and the voice to bring into a song where you could feel what he was singing about. This classic song is a great example of his rich bass voice and the Perrys' amazing harmonies. This song, titled "Where We'll Never Grow Old," was recorded by James Cleveland Moore in 1914. This song came to Moore during his college years, and at the time he was visiting his hometown church to preach. As he heard his father leading the service, he thought about not being able to hear his father singing much more because of his father's age. So he went back to school and wrote this song as a dedication to his mom and dad. This song was not published until 1930, but has been recorded multiple times by major artists including Johnny Cash, the Carter Family, and the Gaithers. but the Perry's version is a great example of taking a simple song with a powerful message and connecting with the audience. So enjoy the Perry's featuring the late Tracy Stuffel. As we end today, I want to thank you for listening to this episode and your continued support for Southern Gospel Music. I want to personally thank Andrew Goldman for his time with me to do the interview. Make sure you check out the Perry's and their music at perrysministries.com. This final closing song is a great classic hymn titled The Heart of the Battle, the Sweeter the Victory, and it's from one of the Perry's latest CDs. Thanks so much for listening and have a great day.
The Sweeter the Victory.
Pressing along, press along, press along with courage, courage true.
For Jesus will lead you through.
When trouble and care your life be tied, He'll always be standing near your side.
For the heart of the battle, the sweeter the victory.
And shame, and suffer the scorn of the world, and bear in Jesus' sweet name,
His wonderful name.
A crown of pure gold will soon obtain the honor and life they failed to gain.
For the heart of the battle, the sweeter the victory.
Keep pressing along.
Standing near your side.
For the heart of the battle, the sweeter the